at that stage of the game. And this has always spoke to me, and it's familiar to us, so I think the familiarity allowed to speak to us even deeper tonight. And it says the Lord would speak to Moses, how? Face to face, as a man speaks to his friends. It's verse 11. He spoke to Moses face to face, like a man speaks to his friend. They said then Moses would return to the camp. In other words, he'd leave the tabernacle, that place, that tent of meeting. But it says his young aide, Joshua, the son of Nun, did not leave the tent. Underline that part, whatever your translation reads. It says that he stayed behind. He did not leave the tent. And so if you want to take the time sometime to read that entire text, that lesson right there is found in verses 7 through 11. And so here's what we saw. We saw Moses, he went to the tent to meet with God, and God didn't disappoint. What happened? He went to meet with God, and God did what? He spoke to him face to face as a man speaks to his friend. How many of you know that we have the power also through faith in the work of the cross to become what? Not just the friend of God, but the sons of God. And so we even got a better place, a better opportunity to them. The veil has been torn away, and we can come boldly into the throne of grace and mercy. Now listen, you guys can probably interrupt me. I could be doing something, and you could come to me and I say, listen, you're interrupting. Well, Micah could never interrupt me. He just couldn't. He'd give me one little smile, that little gap-teeth smile, that little fuzzy-headed boy, and it's no interruption. I'm going to stop everything I'm doing, and I'm going to gather. He can come boldly into my presence anytime that he wants to. He can slobber on me. He can put his slobbery mint in my mouth, and I'm going to... Why? Because the way I look at him... Now, folks, as much as I love that sweet little old boy, man, think about how much our God loves us. Think about that. We have that opportunity to come into that place. And so we see that God didn't disappoint Moses. He could go speak to him face to face as a man spoke to his friend. So God's presence is seen in Moses' life. We see he led him. We saw the pillar that covered and hovered over the entrance to the tabernacle of meeting. The people saw the great sight. They worshiped from their tents and their doors. But while inside, God and Moses spoke just like two friends would be speaking. And so the conversation concludes in that text, and Moses leaves back, and he goes back to his household tent. But the importance for us that are seeking after to be visionary leaders is what happened after Moses left. Well, Joshua didn't depart from the tent. Moses left, the guy that was in charge, the guy that was a pace setter, the guy that was a visionary, the guy that was the deliverer from the people from Egypt with the Exodus, the guy that held up his staff and they parted over. I mean, that guy, he left, but Joshua was going, man, it would be easy for me to leave too. Well, man, I just can't find myself leaving. He said he did not depart from the tent. Folks, you know what's interesting about that? Nobody even mentioned the fact that Joshua was there all along. I mean, it's just kind of a cursory thing, but... You know, I mean, it wasn't no big deal. He just, I don't know what's up with Joshua, man. That dude just, Moses left. Why don't he come on down with us? He just never left. And so, in all of Moses' writing, he does not say that he ever asked Joshua to accompany him. It doesn't say that Moses said, okay, I'm leaving for a while, Joshua. You need to stay here and guard the tent. Never said that. And so, it wasn't that he was, that his leader mandated him, said, okay, you guard the gate because we don't want anybody going in there. He's like, no, they don't want to go in there. It's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of an angry God. That's the last thing. So it never says that Moses said, follow me. It never says Moses said, stay here. It just says that he stayed there. So it doesn't even say that Moses or God ever acknowledged even Joshua's presence during their dialogue. Right. It's, when they was talking to his friends, he said, hey, you know this, what about this dude that's hanging around out here? Moses, man, don't that guy know that we're having a private conversation? They never even acknowledged. He's just out there, just hanging out. Moses never came out and even identified and said, dude, I'm in there talking to God. Backing off just wasn't no big deal. Don't you find that interesting? But I find it prophetic because it goes on to say that he remained. And so we never hear God speaking to Joshua, though, until after Moses is dead. Okay? Even though he hung out by the tent, it didn't say, well, God said, hey, man, it's kind of cool that you hung around. Didn't say anything. Didn't say anything happened until Moses is dead, Joshua chapter 1, verse 2. And it's at that time that he receives the call as a leader of the Israelites. And so here's my question. What qualified him to be Moses' successor? Wasn't mentioned, wasn't told to stick around, doesn't either. What qualified him to follow and to take up the mantle and the responsibility of Moses? Now, think about this just for a second, guys. How was Moses raised? As a what? He was an Egyptian, but even more than that, he was a prince. I mean, we're talking about the adopted grandson of Pharaoh. I mean, he was raised with privilege. So he was highly educated. He had anything that he wanted, probably. I mean, we're talking about a guy that was born with a, not born, but he finally got, after he came through the bulrushes, he had a silver spoon in his mouth. He had everything that he needed. But Joshua, on the contrary, how was he born? He was born a slave. So we had one that was raised as a prince, that had all the privilege, and we had one that was simply a slave. And so all Joshua knew was hard work. All he knew was having a work ethic that, listen, you're on somebody else's time because you're on somebody else's dime. That's all he knew. So there was a work ethic inside of him that probably Moses never had to have. Why? Because he was a person that he wanted something done. He just told somebody else to do it. And so I got this Joshua that all he knew was hard work. All he knew was fighting. That was it. I know how to work. I know how to fight. Now, folks, just because he got delivered doesn't mean that changed. He still had to come to a place of working, and he was still fighting for something bigger than the ceiling that his upbringing had set for him. And so the question is for you. Listen, every single one of us were born slaves. We were born slaves to sin. But the problem is we really don't want to work or fight our way out of that position. We want to be king's kids. Well, folks, there was only one king's kid. There was only one begotten, and that was Jesus the Christ, the Son of the living God. Well, the rest of us are going to be slaves either to sin or we're going to be slaves to righteousness. And so we've got to adopt that type of mentality as visionary leaders that says, listen, God is raising me up out of that slavery, and I'm going to be a slave to righteousness, and it's going to produce the fruit of righteousness. So I would really surmise that this qualification is found really in the time that he spent at the tent. And so in the tent, Joshua learned to sit in the presence of God. He wasn't invited into the conversation. He wasn't given position. He wasn't even acknowledged. And so this one learned to work. He learned to fight by just abiding and sitting in the presence of the God. He qualified himself, and he experienced what God's voice sounded like, even though God was not speaking to him. You hear it?
He did something nobody else was willing to do.
And what was that?
Just stay.
Nobody else was willing to do that, but just stay there, even when he didn't have to stay. And even when it wasn't talking to him. See, here's the problem many times in ministry, in vision. Unless God spoke to us, we don't feel obligated to it. You hear me? Now, folks, there's a reason that, like I said, that I don't have to be on a schedule to go preach on the streets. Because
right.
He spoke that to me. Now, some, if it's not your Thursday, if it's not your whatever, it's like, oh, I'm off tonight. Well, There's a voice that spoke to me that don't let me have off. I don't mean it in a legalistic sense. It burns inside of me. Do you hear me? It burns inside of me. And there's certain things that burn inside of you. Pastor Sam gets his itch scratched by going to those neighborhoods. Nobody has to beg him to go. I don't have to say, preacher, here's your mandate. You got to do that. It burns inside of him to do those type of things. And so for us, we hear that voice. And so what qualifies you to hear your own voice is a willingness to abide even when it's somebody else hearing from God. See, that's what we don't like to do. See, Joshua even stayed longer than Moses did, and Moses was the guy in the conversation.
Right. Yeah.
He demonstrated a deeper commitment time-wise and patience-wise even than the guy that was the one that was walking away thinking, man, I got a glow on me. I got to cover my face because I've been with Jesus. Joshua's like, well, or been with God, been with the Shekinah glory of God. Joshua's like, well, I didn't get to go in there, but you know what? I'm still sticking around. He wasn't saying I'm sticking around because, man, when that guy croaks, I'm jumping in the tent. He wasn't thinking that. He didn't say anything negative about him. What did he do? He just found the best possible place to be with the greatest potential, even if I'm not hearing the voice myself face to face, then I'm gonna get where it's, they're talking.
Yep.
I'm gonna get where they're talking. Mm-hmm. And so for us, we've got to do the exact same thing, have that same type of mentality. Even if God's not speaking something clear to me, I'm gonna get where he's speaking something clear to somebody. Maybe you've heard me. If you don't have a vision for yourself, what do? You remember, I've taught this for years. Yeah, you help somebody else accomplish their vision. That's exactly what Joshua was doing. Listen, I'm not hearing anything specifically. I don't got marching orders. I don't got a mandate myself. And so what I'm going to do, I'm going to stay here, and I'm going to help somebody else accomplish their vision, knowing that, hey, listen, maybe the time will come, God speaks something to me. But in the meantime, man, I'm totally satisfied. I'm just going to camp out right here in that tent of meeting. And so he had that. So his, that's where genuine unction is established in the life of the visionary leader. He abides even though he may not even be able to see himself. And so he just positions himself in a place where he knows God speaks. Say that again. Even though he may not hear the voice himself, he just puts himself in a place where he hears God speaking. Here's what something the Lord spoke to me 25 years ago. He said, son, here's the problem. He said, what we do is we get our will and we want God to line up with it. Rather than saying, God, what's your will, and us lining up with his will. That's what most people that claim to have a vision for ministry do. They say, here's my plan. God bless it. God said, stop telling me to bless your plan, and you start being a part of the plan that I've already blessed. Doesn't that make a lot of sense? God, don't anoint what I'm doing. I just want to do what you're anointing. Well, that just speeds up the whole process. God, what are you anointing? What is your hand on? What are you blessing? Where are hearts and lives being changed? That's where I'm going to dive into. I'm going to find myself smack dab in the middle of where I see God showing up and God showing out. I'm not going to say, well, that's real fine for somebody else, and I'm going to get myself back on the backside of this where I can get credit and I can have my billboard, and hopefully God will show up one day and he said, man, you really done that good. I guess I'll put my rubber stamp on it. No, I'm going to say, God, where is your hand at? And God, I'm going to fling myself wholeheartedly smack dab in the middle of what you're blessing and what you're anointing. That way, I don't have to have a good idea. I can have a vision that's derived from the heart of God that comes from patiently enduring and waiting in his presence. So Joshua sacrificed time. He sacrificed comfort. He sacrificed relationships. He obviously probably sacrificed a whole lot of rest, right? Because he didn't go looking for a shortcut to position or power, because he didn't have the chance to go to any prophecy conferences or run under a fire tunnel or hear somebody say, boom, shakalaka to him, or he didn't get any glory clouds or angel feathers or gold dust or precious stones. He didn't get any of that stuff. All he got was, I'm going to stay when everybody else goes. And so I want to say this, remember this, the primary instrument in regards to visionary leader development is patience and a willingness to persevere through times of prolonged silence and isolation. I want to say that again because this is important to you. The primary instrument in regards to visionary leadership development is patience and a willingness to persevere through times of prolonged silence and isolation. See, we think it's the boom shakalakas. Actually, it's perseverance, it's patience, it's a willingness to persevere. It's patience and a willingness to persevere through times of prolonged silence and isolation. The primary instrument in regards to visionary leadership development is patience and a willingness to persevere through times of prolonged silence and isolation. That's what Joshua did. What was the payoff? I'm glad you asked. Joshua chapter 1, verse 1. After the death of Moses, the Lord's servant, the Lord spoke to Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' assistant. After the death of Moses, why? Because he was willing to endure through patience, perseverance, through times of prolonged silence, through times of isolation. After the death of Moses, the Lord spoke to Joshua, the son of Nun, his assistant. He said this, Moses, my servant, is dead. Therefore, the time has come for you to lead these people to the Israelites across the Jordan River and into the land that I am giving them. After the death of Moses. Write that down in your notes, underline it in your Bible. After the death of Moses. Folks, why couldn't Moses lead the people into the promised land? He struck the rock. You know what it comes down to? It's for the same reasons that many leaders never move past the understanding stage into the unction stage. It really comes down to the exact same reason. Because you have leaders, and Moses, obviously God spoke to him, so he had understanding, he had information. But what kept him from moving over into the promised land? He never obtained that promise. Folks, can you imagine only having information but never having an intimate relationship with Christ? Can you imagine, 28 years ago, saying I do to Lucy, and then parting company and never partaking of an intimate relationship with your spouse? I mean, how miserable would that be? And people say, hey, I want to meet your wife. I say, well, I do too. I hadn't seen her in 28 years. Never spent any time with her. No, we've parted ways. We're married, though. Folks, that's what that would be like. And so Moses had that marriage, so to speak. He had that opportunity. But because he did something contrary to God's heart and God's will, he never got to enter into the promised land. So consider, Moses was not allowed to enter the promised land because, just like Chris said, he struck the rock twice instead of what? Speaking to the rock like God had told him to. Numbers 20, we find this account. So the Israelites in the wilderness was in, and they were without water. And Moses and Aaron prayed, and God spoke to Moses. And here's what he said. Numbers chapter 20, he said, take the rod, and you and your brother, you know what a rod speaks of scripturally? What's a type of? It's a type of authority. So he took that authority, he took the vision. Folks, because when you have vision, you have authority. You hear me? You do. I mean, vision will produce authority because people will gravitate towards vision. So he said, I want you to take the vision that I've given you, take that authority, and with your brother Aaron, now look what he said. He said, I want you to assemble the congregation. Some of your translations may say something a little different. What do they say? Bring the people together, I think maybe the King James says, if anybody using that. He said, I want you to assemble the congregation, and I want you to speak to the rock before their eyes, that it may yield its water. And you will thus bring forth water for them out of the rock, and let the congregation, I'm intentionally emphasizing that word, let the congregation and their animals drink. Folks, listen, as leaders, as potential leaders, as visionary leaders, you've got to pay attention to what God says when God says it. You hear me? He was very specific on what he told Moses. And so it wasn't, listen, I want you to get close. I want you to fake it until you make it. He says, listen, here's what I want you to do. And folks, a misstep, an act of disobedience, or not following through what God got to, it can keep you out of your promised land. It can keep you from attaining that place that God desires for you. God said, assemble the congregation. Assemble, circle that. As a visionary leader, some of you guys that are called to be pastors, circle that, underline it, get it in your heart and mind, because missing that may cause you to miss the fulfillment of what God told you to do. And I'm going to explain why. That's the utilization of the base Hebrew word, which is adaw. You can write down A-Y-D-A-W. You can look it up in your interlinear later. But here, it's rendered hay-adaw. So H-A-Y-A-Y-D-A-W. And it has come from a word. The base of the word is a word that can mean anything from a group of wicked marauders to just a gathering of people. And so if he said, I want you to gather together the Adaw, it could be anybody. It's just people in general. But he didn't say, I want you to bring together the Adaw. He said, I want you to bring together the Hey Adaw, which was specifically a Hebrew word that spoke of a term of endearment towards an invited group of people that I desire to fellowship with. And so God spoke to Moses, and he said, listen, I'm endearing myself to this people, and I want you to go and bring together, call together these people that I have a term of endearment towards, this Hey Adaw, this group of people that are I want to fellowship with. Now, you ask yourself, why is that important? Well, look what Moses did. Verse 9. It says, so Moses took the rod before the Lord, just as he commanded. So he took the vision, he took the rod, he took his place of authority as the Lord commanded. And now something happened. Moses and Aaron gathered the assembly before the rock, and he said to them, listen now, you rebels. Listen now, you rebels. Shall we bring forth water for you out of this rock? Did you catch that? He said, I want you to bring together the Hey Adaw, but Moses didn't see them as an endearing people. He had allowed himself somewhere along the line to get jaded in his calling. And he said, even though he loves you, even though he's endeared to you, hey, you bunch of rebels, I want you to come together and we're going to show you what we're going to do. So you see where that paradigm changed? Moses ceased to see the people like God saw them, and he ceased to see that it was God was the one that was going to bring it out. And he said, we're going to do something for you. Folks, that's an easy trap. You can read through that a dozen times and miss that a dozen times. I know I have. But when you finally look at it and say, well, what happened there? So God told him to gather a people dear to my heart. But Moses said, addressed them as rebels, or the word mada, which places them in a place of rebellion, provocation, and disobedience. That's not what God said to them. And so as a visionary leader, I'll never be able to rightly say what I can't righteously see. I want to say that again. As a visionary leader, you'll never be able to rightly say what you cannot righteously see. You'll never be able to rightly say what you can't righteously see. The problem with Moses, he couldn't see those folks like God saw those folks. And so unction is where you've heard me use the terminology for 20 years. When you see it like he saw it, then you'll do it like he did it. You'll see the people from his vantage point. That's what keeps you going. That's what gets you moved with compassion rather than moved with disgust. Do you hear me? That's what keeps you from getting burned out. Why? Because you don't want to see people burned up. And so you're willing to go and rescue people. Why? Because of that unction. And so, once again, that testimony, Mardi Gras, 1996, that's exactly what happened to me. The Matthew 9:36, that God just pulled the scales off of my eyes, and I saw the multitudes finally. I say finally because I've been saved for many years, had been pastoring a church for years, but I had never seen them from that vantage point. I could easily see the Ma-Da, but I could not see the Hey-A-Da. I could see a bunch of rebellious people, but never had God really pierced my heart and allowed me to see people from his vantage point, which was the vantage point of the cross of Calvary. When we have that, what does Luke 22:34 says? It says, when we see them from that perspective, we say, Father, forgive them. They do not know what they are doing. And so this is what the ultimate visionary leader said, which was Jesus. Was he the ultimate visionary leader? He said, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. And so if I'm going to follow in the footsteps of Jesus as a visionary, as a leader, as somebody in the body of Christ, what do I have to do? I have to have his vantage point on the situation. He was called what? The anointed one. He was called the one that originated this stage, this unction, John 1:41. He was given the Spirit without measure. He had this stage without measure, John 3:34. And he abode in prayer. He was the one that stayed there in Gethsemane, Matthew 20 and 12. And so he stayed there, and because he stayed there, what did he see? He saw things from the vantage point that God desired him to see things from the vantage point of. And so what was the consequence upon Moses for lacking vision? Verse 11, it says, then Moses lifted up his hand and he struck the rock twice with his rod, and water came forth abundantly in congregation. And the beasts drank, the animals drank from it. But the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, because you have not believed me, the very ones that spoke to God face to face as a man, spoke to his friend, did not believe him. He said, you didn't believe me, and so as a result, you did not treat me as holy in the sight of the sons of Israel. Therefore, you shall not bring the assembly into the land which I have given to them. Spoke to you, tried to teach you, tried to instruct you, but you didn't even consider me holy on that day. You had the right information, but somehow you abandoned that place of unction and intimacy. And so Moses was told to speak to the rock, and said he called the people rebels. And he said, shall we bring forth water? Implying that he was the one doing the work, and it was him and Aaron that was going to do it for the people. But it wasn't, right? It was the Lord who would provide that life-giving water. So he spoke, speaking to the rock, probably might also symbolize the word of God as given to Moses, or speaking that vision where striking the rock represents Moses' own efforts. And so the life-giving water is the result of God's word, not man's efforts. Folks, listen. Understanding can be acquired by our own efforts. You can. You can go and get you a book. You can get on the website. You can get understanding by your own efforts. But unction only comes obedience in his presence. That's it. You can make every effort you want to and say to yourself, listen, I want to acquire knowledge. Yeah, you can. The Bible says in the last days that knowledge will increase. Just get in line. It's going to be happening to everyone. But the anointing only comes from him as we're willing to wait upon him. Get into that place of abiding. Joshua 1:1-9, I want to read that again. It says, after the death of Moses, the Lord's servant, the Lord spoke to Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' assistant, and said, Moses, my servant, is dead. Therefore, the time has come for you to lead these people, the Israelites, across the River Jordan into the land I'm giving them. Verse 3, I promise you what I promised him. Wherever you put your foot, that will be the land that I give to you. From the Negev wilderness to the south, of the Lebanon mountains to the north, from the Euphrates River to the east, to the Mediterranean Sea to the west, including all the land of the Hittites, no one will be able to stand against you as long as you live, for I will be with you just as I was with Moses, and I will not fail you or abandon you. Be strong and very courageous, for you are the one who will lead these people to possess all the land that I swore to their ancestors that I would give them. Be strong, be very courageous, be careful to obey all the instructions that Moses gave you. Do not deviate from them. Do not turn to the right or to the left, and you will be successful in everything that you do. Study the book of instruction, continually meditate it upon day and night, so you will be sure to obey everything. Somebody say everything. If I say speak, you speak. I didn't say hit it. I said speak it. Obey everything written in it. Only then will you prosper and succeed in all that I tell you to do. This is my command. Be strong and very courageous. Do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord our God is with you wherever you go. All of this could be attributed, what? To a willingness to wait and be patient. Did you hear what he offered him? Every place that you go, it's going to be yours to take. I'll be with you like I was with him. No one will be able to stand against you all the days of your life. I will not abandon you. You'll be successful in everything that you do. You're going to be the one that leads these people. Why? Because you waited and you were patient. It doesn't give us all hope. It does to me. Because, folks, when I came to Christ, that's all I had to offer. I didn't have the pedigree. I didn't have a great ability. But I could wait. I could be patient. I could depend upon him. And so if you're at that place and you're saying, God, I need you to show me something. I need you to reveal something to me. Folks, what's going to qualify you for that is just your willingness to wait, not to be anxious for anything, but learn what it genuinely means. Just trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Don't lean on your own understanding. I need to smack the rock. I need to call him real. Don't do that. In all of your ways, just acknowledge him and what's going to happen. He's going to direct your path. And look where that path takes you. You ever think about that? Look where that path takes you. It takes you into a place of victory in those areas that God wants to call you to. So all of it's attributed to being willing to wait and patience. James 1:4, you know it. Let patience have its perfect work, its perfect result, that you can be perfect and complete in lacking nothing. 2 Corinthians 12:12. I love this. The sign of a true apostle were performed among you first with all patience. Don't you love that? What differentiated the apostles first and foremost was not all these wondrous things that they did. First and foremost, it was patience. Think about that. We're built upon the foundations of the apostles and the prophets, but the thing that marked them first and foremost was patience or perseverance, and then by signs and wonders and miracles. And so patience will always precede power. Write that down. Patience will always precede power. Patience will always precede power, but impatience will always produce pride. Impatience will always produce pride. Patience will always precede power, but impatience will always produce pride. Show me an impatient person. I'll show you a person that, when confronted with their impatience, will blow up like an old toad. Every time. If you tell them, listen, they come to you and say, hey, listen, here's what I want to do. Here's what I think. Here's what I, well, let's just wait for a minute. Well, who are you to tell me? Well, the guy you just asked. That's who I am. If you didn't care what I thought, you shouldn't have asked me. You should have just done it. Just tell you, calm down, whoa, Nelly. Let's just wait, let's just endure, let's just hold back just a little bit. Well, impatience will always produce pride, where patience will always precede the power of God. And so this place that we call unction, or I'm calling unction, or the second stage in developing the visionary leadership, is really probably the most time-consuming of all three. It really is. That's the time-consuming one, that number two that we're looking at. But it's the place that every single one of us, just like I keep saying, we're always going to revisit that place. Why? Because that's where we abide. That's where we live, in this place
right here.
And so there's two aspects of this that I've shared for really a lot of years in sermon form, and I'm going to get a little bit more detail in it in this class. But I've shared these aspects of what I'm talking about kind of in generalities, really for any believer that's going to, but I'm going to share with you how it's going to really function in your life as a visionary during this class. These things are really tied closely together, but what you're going to find out, just as really God revealed some things to me that changed my life, I think they're going to work the same in you. And the first one of these things, and we're going to try to touch on, I've got a little bit of time still yet tonight, is the issue of repentance. How do I function here? How do I stay? How do I function? And I'm using that rhyme again because it just sounds so funny. How do I function in that unction right here? What keeps me there? What keeps me abiding? It's called repentance. Because, listen, guys, let's just be honest. Isn't waiting one of the toughest things you have to do? It's tougher than actually doing, isn't it? I mean, if somebody says, I want you to do something you're uncomfortable with, it's easier to do something and get it over with than it is to wait to do something. Isn't it? Patience. And so the only thing that can keep us in that place of patiently enduring is this thing that we call repentance. About 20 years ago, and I told you guys that I'm not using the textbook because I'm just using my experiences. Probably about then, probably about 1996. I preached 6 months of messages, and I'm not even exaggerating, 6 months of messages out of two verses. Two verses, I preached 6 months of messages. I'm talking Sunday morning, Wednesday night, for six solid months, I never deviated from two solitary verses. So if I came to you as a young preacher, Gideon, I said, listen, 6 months, that would be about 26 weeks, double that down, 52 sermons, and I'm just going to give you two passages to use. You'd have your work cut out for you, wouldn't you? Well, I did too. But what was God teaching me? He wasn't just giving me a message on repentance. He was teaching me what it looked like. Well, Matthew chapter 3, verses 1 and 2, here's those two verses that I preached in for 6 months. But we're not going to stay there for 6 months. Somebody say amen. You might, but I'm not tonight. In those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Kingdom of heaven is at hand. In other words, the influence of who God is within reach. It's attainable. So if you want to think about it in their term, repent because what God wants to accomplish, thy will be done on earth, how? As it is in heaven. How many of you know that his kingdom does not come with observation? The kingdom is inside of us. And so when they come saying lo, lo, and all those things, don't think that that's the time yet. And so repent for the influence of his kingdom is attainable. And so here we have John the Baptist showed up on the scene all of a sudden, okay? Not really any fanfare. A lot like I always think of him, that, you know, he talks about coming in the spirit of Elijah. Same type of thing. You know, Elijah shows up in what is it, 1 Kings chapter 17? Elijah the Tishbite. Here he is before King Ahab. All of a sudden, we get John the Baptist doing the same thing. Obviously, both of those guys had been in some type of patience and preparation because, you know, here he was, you know, 30 years old plus. What's he been doing? Well, he's been patient. He's been enduring. He's been preparing his heart so he could prepare the way, right? And so he had to do a preparation in him so he could be the one that would prepare the way. And it's going to be the same thing for you as a visionary and for a person in the ministry. He can't prepare you to prepare the way until he prepares you the way that he desires. That's a mouthful, isn't it? He can't prepare you to prepare the way until he prepares you in the way that he desires to prepare you. And so if you're wondering to yourself, well, God, why doesn't it seem like I'm being able to paint this wonderful picture and do these things? Well, because he's still preparing you to prepare the way, the right way that he desires it to be. And so here we had John the Baptist, much just like Elijah. Obviously, they were somewhere doing something, acquiring an unction. You hear me? So it wasn't a waste of time. And so when you say to yourself, the hardest thing for me to do is just to wait. Well, what are you doing? You're acquiring an unction. And so it's not like it's a waste of time. God has positioned you in a place. It's kind of like you're running out of gas and you're running late and you're on E and you stop at the pump real quick and your temptation is, man, I'm just going to get a dollar and I'll fill it up later. Well, what happens? You just keep chasing that dollar. Rather than saying, I'm just going to wait, I'm going to fill it up all the way to the top. That way I can keep going. Folks, sometimes God just has you stop at the pump, so to speak. He's like, just calm down. That extra 5 minutes is going to give you a full tank of gas. It's going to carry you a lot further than that dollar at a time is ever going to do it. And so here he was, acquiring the unction that would transform and empower him. And then he suddenly, John the Baptist, thrust upon the scene, and he's got this audience that wasn't necessarily welcoming his message. Right? And so what was his message? Huh? Let's not use that word. Let's take that answer off the table. What was his message? What was his message? What was his message? You know what his message really was? His message was visionary leadership. Because God's not willing that any should perish. And so we would like to think that John was going to show up on the thing and he's going to wipe out the Pharisees and the Sanhedrin. He's just going to lay them low. But really, he came and he was giving them the answer to this. Do you realize when John showed up on the scene, he was saying, guys, listen, I know you. You forget the house that I got raised up in. You forget who my father was. We got the understanding. And so when John showed up with that message in Matthew chapter 3 and verse 1 and 2, what he was doing is he was trying to bring them from this place into a place of the realization of visionary leadership. Folks, listen. Who came up? Who established the tribes? Who established the priesthood? That was God's idea. That was part of God's vision. And so John didn't come to nullify that. God came to fulfill that. John came to fulfill that because Jesus didn't come to do away with the law, but that the law through him might be fulfilled. And so as the Pharisees, the parts of the Sanhedrin, the Sadducees, when John showed up, his message was a message of visionary leadership. Obviously, it was a message of repentance, but you're going to see how the message of repentance is the catalyst for visionary leadership. And so he walks up and he says, listen, repent, guys. You're here, but you need to change the way that you think. Okay, you got the information, you got that. But you need to change the way you think, and you've got to see the importance of intimacy in regards to the ministry and the call that God has for us. So that was the message that they totally missed. Unfortunately, that's the message that the church has missed. Because we hear the word repentance, we don't think to ourselves, praise God, God's going to change the way I think so I can change the world. You hear me? Because when I change the world, I change the way I'm thinking. What's happened? John has showed back up on the scene. The voice of Elijah has shown back up on the scene and said, listen, I want to prepare you to prepare the way. And so, what did we talk about last week? Proverbs 23:7. For as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. And so, if I'm not functioning as a visionary leader in the body of Christ, what's going to happen? I'm not going to be that guy. And so, if God can take me and show me, to allow me to see things like he sees things, then I'm able to do things like he does things, but I'm going to have to change the way that I think. I'm going to have to say, God, I want you to come in, and even though I have all of this, man, I've just got a bunch of information. Bring me to thinking from the foundation and the basis of an intimate relationship with you that's going to produce man's much fruit. And so John basically came and called them out on something that was previously spoken, but had never widely been applied. But remember, as a man thinketh, not what a man thinketh. And so John came and said, you folks have been thinking about a lot of whats, but you're really not thinking about a way. Now folks, listen, those people that he came and brought that message to, they knew the what, did they not? They knew that what you should do and what you shouldn't do. They knew what you should eat and what you shouldn't eat. They knew what you should touch and what you shouldn't touch. They knew what days you should celebrate and what days you shouldn't celebrate, what days you should work. They knew the what, but they didn't know the way or the why. They had no idea about those things. They were just heavy on the what, and they lost their way. So repentance changed everything because it brought a man to a place of altering not just what he did, but who he was on the inside. And so prior to that, they were essentially what-focused and could not realize the heart of God. And so they were all law, which is what, and they were no life, which was way. So folks, I can have, once again, I can have the what and be lifeless. I need to have the way inside of me that's going to produce a life. And so it's easy in leadership to think that everything that we do is what motivated rather than way, why, or as motivated. And so we ask ourselves the question, it's not what I do, it's why I do it. It's not what am I feeding them on a Monday, Wednesday, or Friday, it's why am I doing that? There's a purpose behind that. Because really, the methodology, whether it's a bowl of a jambalaya or a big 15-foot red cross, that's just the what.
Right.
And even if the what changes, it doesn't change the why or the way, the motivation behind it. Well, we found that out this past week, and we got there, and our PA wasn't charged. Well, what we do is usually stand underneath the 15-foot cross, and somebody preaches, and the rest witness. Well, we didn't have that. So we say, man, I guess we're done. I said, let me go put that back in the car, and we'll stand in the cross. And you know what happened? I ministered all night. I had some of the best conversations I've had in a long time. Why? Because it wasn't about the what. It was about the why and the way. I was presenting the way to Jesus Christ, whether it was when verbally at the top of my voice or if it was on the PA system. It didn't change a single thing. And so that way of thinking produced in John the Baptist the mindset that was essential in the lives of visionary leaders, and that is I've got to decrease the what so that he can increase as the way. And so I want to be less about the what in my life, and I want to be more about the way that he has for me. I'm going to give you four verses, five verses actually. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 8 says this. It says, therefore, he said when he ascended on high that he led captivity captive and did what? Gave gifts to men. How many of you think that God has given you a gift? Anybody? What gift has he given you, Hope? Oh, you said he gave you one, but once I ask you what it is, you're like, oh, I don't know. What gift has he given you? You have no idea. Isn't it easy to raise our hand and give you a gift?
He's given you, Pastor Sam,
giving us
and all my brothers around
giving
me.
Giving the brothers and sisters. Well, he played it safe. He's like, hey, yes, we're his gift. Amen. No, what do you mean by gifts?
Right.
Huh?
Nobody else determines what you think if there's only you do.
So I asked you if you had a gift. I didn't say, here's your gift. I said, what's your gift? Got a gift?
He gave me a second chance.
Gift of a second chance. What else is a gift he's given you? Huh? Give you the gift of faith? Anybody else? Did he give you any gifts?
Grace.
Huh?
Grace.
Give you the gift of grace? Those are all gifts. Well, James 1:17 says what? Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights, who there's no variableness in, there's no shadow of turning. So if God gives us a gift, what is it? It's good. It's perfect. Now, Romans 2:4, if every gift is good, right? Romans 2:4 says, do you not know that the goodness of God leads us to repentance? Folks, the best gift that I ever got was called that gift of repentance. The gift to be able to change my mind. Because what if I'd have been locked into a way of thinking and I just said, listen, that's just the way it is. That's the way mama did it. That's the way grandma did it. That's the way great-grandmother did it. And that's just the way I'm going to do it. But the good news is God gave me the gift to change my mind. How did I get that gift? What activated that gift? Huh? His love? Well, it was the gift that he gave to Vera. It's called that gift of grace. It was that gift of God's divine influence upon the heart and its reflection in life. Folks, listen. I never could change my own heart. Never could, never would. Why is that? Because my heart was what? Deceitful? It was wicked above all things? How could I know? How could I ever change something when I was so deceived. I didn't realize I needed to get changed. And so I did not have the ability to change my own heart, but God, through his influence, gave me the ability to change my mind. And once I was willing to change my mind, change my will, make that decision, God was able to come in and change my heart. And so the gift that he gave me was that thing that we gave up at the fall, which was called the ability of self-determination. We call it free will. Folks, listen, free will was given. We talk about man having free will. The only reason we can have free will now is because of the grace of God. Because otherwise, we would never choose right. We couldn't. Because once Adam fell, all those attributes that were associated with the person of God fell with him. One of those was the ability to choose to live righteously. We cannot. Paul the Apostle said in Romans chapter 7, the things that I want to do, even though I had the right information, couldn't do them. He didn't say I wouldn't do them. He just said I couldn't do them. The things that I said I'd never do, I ended up doing them. Oh, wretched man that I am. I've got a wretched heart. And so he gives the perfect gift of repentance, the ability to change the way I think. Folks, listen. If there's anything that will be your go-to gift as a visionary leader, it's going to be repentance. It's not going to be our Shandas and our Ikimohas. I like those. It's not going to be all that other stuff. It's always your go-to gift as a visionary leader is constantly going to be repentance. Why is that, do you think? Why would I say that? Why would you think I'd say that, Chris? He didn't. Yeah. And why didn't he have that option? Because there was no cross. There was no cross. At best, he could function right here. At best. But see, we've got a new and a living what? Oh, I'm sorry. It doesn't say that. The covenant that we have through the blood of Jesus is a new and living way. All at best, they had a very good what. We've got a new and a living way. And so through that, what do we have? We have the ability to think differently. God comes in and changes our heart because now we live in this wonderful, beautiful age of grace that has visionary leaders. We don't have to say, listen, that's what my denomination thought, so I have to think that way. We can say, listen, I was in prayer. I was abiding with God for the last 3 hours. Here's what God said. He confirmed it through his word. I'm changing the way I think. I was walking in unforgiveness towards someone. God convicted me of that. I seen in his word where that vision don't line up with my unforgiveness. What am I going to do? And God gave me the ability to change the way that I thought. Folks, that's power. Yeah. You hear what I'm saying? That is power made manifest in our hearts and lives. That just because I functioned and lived and thought like a loser before Christ Jesus, Christ Jesus came in and he gave me a good and perfect gift to change the way that I think. To change my mind, give me the mind of Christ. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Knowing that the goodness of God leads to repentance. 2 Timothy 2:25 says this. He says, gently instruct those who oppose the truth. Do what? Blow them up. Go on Facebook. Shred them. He said, gently instruct those who oppose the truth. Isn't it funny how we can pick out the verses we like and we don't like ones like this sometimes? Gently instruct those who oppose the truth. Perhaps God will give repentance to those people's hearts as well, and they'll think differently concerning the truth. Isn't that a challenge to us Rambo Christians? Amen. Romans 12:2, we know that. Don't be conformed to the image of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind so you can know what's the good, every good gift, acceptable and perfect will of God. Folks, listen, repentance is not merely man's response to sin. It's man's response to God. That's what it is. Repentance is me staying right here long enough that I can respond to God rightly. That's where I get the gift of repentance, by abiding in his presence. I think differently. Why? Because when everyone else leaves the tent, I stay there. When everyone gives up and says it ain't even worth it, I stay there. That's what your attitude's got to be. Listen, when I'm not even hearing God's voice, I still stay there. Why? Because God's goodness is going to be found there. So what I'm going to do is, even though I'm not hearing his voice, I'm going to put myself where his voice is heard. And eventually, Moses is going to die, and God is going to extend that mandate to me. So as long as repentance is seen as a response to sin, the mind of Christ will never be realized. I'm going to give you something. We may talk about it in length. You've heard me preach on this several times about what repentance is. I'll just put it on the board so you can write this down maybe for next time. I may get to it, may not. Here's how I think in terms of repentance. Number one, I think in terms of recognition. The Word of God says that he that hides his sin, what? will not prosper. And so recognition is my willingness to do like David did and said, search me, O God, know my heart. Try me, know my thoughts. Tell me, show me. Is there anything wicked inside of me? God, I want to recognize those things that are inside of me. God, whatsoever things are made manifest are made manifest by the light, and those things are light. And so I want to recognize, I want God to show me those things in the light of his word. The second thing is this thing called renunciation. You've been around me long enough. How much power does the devil have over you? As much as you give him. And so the only power and the authority that he has because of the finished work of the cross, because at the cross of Calvary, the Word of God says that Jesus took all power from him. He made an open show of him, and he triumphed over him in the cross of Calvary. And so now all he has is he's the accuser of the brethren. He walks in fear and intimidation. And so if the enemy has power over my mind, if he has power over my marriage, he has power over my vision, he has power over my ministry, where'd he get it? He got it from me. And so what do I got to do? I've got to take it back. I've got to renounce that power and say, listen, Satan, you're trespassing. Yes, I yielded you that power. I gave it to you by an act of my own will, but I'm taking it back. I'm taking back that unforgiveness. I'm taking back that bitterness. I'm taking back that laziness. I'm taking back whatever it was, presuppositions. I'm taking back that pride. I'm taking back the power in those areas that I've given you, and I am renouncing that, and I'm yielding back that power to the one that bought me with a price. I'm giving power back. Why? Because God will honor that. And so I can either make a covenant with God or I can make a covenant with the enemy. And so whoever I yield myself to, give power to, I become their slave. And so what does that produce? That produces this beautiful thing called reconciliation. What's a good definition of reconciliation? Restored to what? Restored to a place of divine favor. Which if you were in divine favor, you'd be back to that place that you used to be. So reconciliation is being restored back to divine favor. In other words, I'm restored back to the place of the mind of God. And so I recognize those things that keep me from that. I renounce their power, and what does God do? He brings me back into that place of promise. Moses gets to die right here, and Joshua gets to take the mantle right here. And the fourth thing, revelation. That's the unveiling of Christ. I recognize the shortcomings. I break their power through renouncing them. I now find myself back at the place, the tent of meeting, where I receive that marching order and I receive the revelation. Folks, listen. That's why repentance is so important to the visionary leader. Because all of these things is what's going to bring us back to that place of knowing exactly what God has for us. Folks, here's the thing. Repentance is not a drag race. Because that's where it gets preached. You tell people, say, listen, you need to repent. They say, well, I did repent. Well, when did you repeat? Well, last week I got drunk and I repented. Well, what people think it is repentance is like, you know, you go to a drag race and they got the lights that go down, and as soon as it hits green, pedal to the metal, and you go a quarter of a mile as wide open as you can, and at the end of the quarter of a mile, you stop, and it's like, whew, glad that's over. Well, that's not repentance. That's feeling bad about your sin and just saying, God, please forgive me for I feel bad, so I want this race to be over. Well, no, repentance looks like that track there in Daytona Beach. That big, long oval that they just keep going around and around. same place. I keep recognizing, I keep renouncing, I keep getting reconciled, I keep getting revelation. Folks, listen, repentance will be your best friend. Why? Because repentance is the goodness of God. It's that gift. It's always going to be that go-to place. So if I can walk in repentance, I'm going to walk in the fulfillment of the vision that God called me to. Amen.